back, everyone, to the ELETS Digital Pharma Summit. After an enlightening inaugural session, we now move on to the first panel discussion of the day on how adoption of digital technologies helped pharma companies during the pandemic. I welcome Mr. Nitish Kumar, Digital Team in the panel, President, Medical Affairs and Clinical Research, IPFA Laboratory. Welcome, sir. Mr. Narendra Saini, Chief Digital Officer, Lupin, and Mr. Ratanu Bhaumik, Chief Technology Officer, DK Pharma. I welcome all the esteemed industry leaders to this session. I would now request Mr. Nitish Kumar to take over the mantle. Sir, over to you.
Thanks, Karima. Thank you so much. So, I hope I am audible for everyone. As a digital business partner, in strides, I'm handling the digital and IT initiative in the area of supply chain, manufacturing, R&D, and I'm also leading the data and analytics practice. Welcome all in this live session of digital technologies and how digital is going to impact the pharma in general to business. I would like to start this discussion. First questions I would like to ask with Narendra. This question will be directed. So Narendra, welcome to the session. We have seen a lot of changes which is happening in the last 4 or 5 quarters because of this COVID, because of this pack which is happening in the area of sales, in the area of supply chain, manufacturing. You name it, and the entire value chain is getting impacted in some way or another because of it. So I just wanted to understand what was your experiences in the last 2 years, besides, and how your company had dealt with all the disruptions happening in the supply chain, which is happening in the manufacturing, and how the digital technologies helped you to overcome the disruptions which has come.
Yeah, good morning, Nitish. Good morning, everyone. Happy to join here. Coming to your question, Nitish, there is a complete change after COVID, right? Post-COVID and pre-COVID eras are completely different. While pre-COVID, it was digital adoption was a challenge, and we had to go to each and every department, and we have something new, probably we can do something better. But now that was more of a push, right? Now the COVID times have created a pull from the business teams as well. Okay, now this is a big change, right? So until unless there is a mindset change, and people would like to get into digital adoption, it is very difficult to push digital adoption on anyone for that matter, right? So that's one big change, and I think across pharma sector, almost every company had faced a lot of turbulent times in last couple of years. It gave us also a time and sufficient bandwidth to rethink how our new digital architecture should look like. Right, delivering digital services is a different ballgame than the conventional IT that we have been doing. So I think. There is enough push because of the COVID times and post COVID. It's a different era that we have. And almost there is a pull mechanism from the business looking for different solutions, looking at something which can be automated, looking at some of the process automation parts, some of the automation on the shop floor, being it in the supply chain side or anywhere for that matter. Right. So technology adoption has increased. That also means that the capex commitment from all the organizations, all the management has also increased. It's not only true for our company, it is across the board. Almost all pharma companies are committing more capital expenses towards the digital adoption, new technology adoption here. So I think there's a big change. The key thing that how we have done it, we have done a complete revision of our target state architecture. The previous architecture probably did not have sufficient depth where it could deliver the digital solutions to the to the people on the shop floor, to the people on the supply chain, and the you know in the sales and marketing department or in R&D. So we are completely revamping the backend architecture to be able to deliver the values. Not taking a lot of time, I think I'll hear from other panelists and we continue the discussion. With this, back to you. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks, Narendra. I think moving forward, I would like to ask next question to Dr. Anil. Dr. Anil, welcome to the forum.
Thank you.
Related questions which Narendra answered, similar to that, we know that pharmaceutical industry is, I would say, little bit laggard in terms of digital technology adoption as you compare to other industries like banking, financial, right? So how does this entire COVID journey of last 6-7 quarters has influenced your company to adopt digital technologies in true sense, which has been missing over the years in the pharma industry? And what are some latest digital technologies with which your company is experimenting and in which area?
Okay, thank you for your for inviting me and having me here. What I would like to say is that definitely what I think Narendra pointed out very rightly, that it has, you know, changed the whole paradigm. Earlier people were, you know, little skeptical on, you know, internet. Now the management also itself is very, very receptive, because everybody suddenly realized the importance of digital technology, because all of us were forced to go digital in sense. But the preparations, I think, have been going on. Like automation has been there in the pharma industry, in manufacturing for long, because the camera detects, you know, whether the tablets are proper size or not. So all these things were automation in that sense, you know, the digitalization has been there. Like I would say in late 90s, I was working with Ranbaxy, and at that time, digital content, was being shared with all the doctors, you know, all important information on the internet. But this time, what we had was, earlier we used to have a virtual, you know, CME. That is how we used to have actual physical meetings only, not hardly any, webinars were conducted. So this forced us to remain in touch with our doctors, which are direct, you know, prescribers of the products of pharma industry. So to remain in touch with them, you had to, forced to adopt, digital CMEs and all that were done. Medical affairs, because I want to talk about medical affairs function, that is what I deal with, medical affairs and clinical research. So in medical affairs, we introduced new products during this time, and because we are traveling was not there, so it was virtual adoption of new product introduction was done to the the field force. We just they were connected digitally, and we had to broadcast these meetings, introduction of new products, which launch meetings we can never think of, that launch meetings taking place digitally. I'm sitting in my office and I'm briefing our sales people on this. So this is one thing. Then other thing which happened was, the doctors also wanted to have, teleconsultations. They also wanted to avoid physical contact with their patients. So in that also, pharma industry indirectly helped us them in getting that. So these were the, many things. And then now what is happening is, having realized the importance of digital and getting in touch with the doctors, now you have your contents, important references and important, disease briefings. All these things can happen, digital. It is possible to contact a plethora of customers digitally and use your digital reach, because your sales personnel may not be able to reach, you may not be able to reach so many customers. So, it is increasing your reach. So digital technology adoption is basically increasing your reach to the customers and to your, peers. So that's what is happening. But when we see adoption of digital, I think pharma industry is now forced to, you know, adopt to the digital, because right from, say, research and development, where 3D technology is being adopted in manufacturing of, you know, pharma products. So US FDA has already approved a product, an anti-epileptic product, which is used for, you know, which is manufactured by 3D printing. So 3D printing being done right from, you know, research and development. Then you have big data analytics, which is there. So you can analyze patterns and, you know, you identify your way to, you know, with big data analytics, you can identify patterns and you can see where the next innovation you can take place. So all these are things which are going to happen. But at present, I think it is just, we have just scratched the surface, I would say. I don't say that we have, you know, made full use of digital technologies. We have a long way to go to embrace digital technology fully. And I think we have to not yet realize the full potential. And then this has given us idea that we can realize the full potential of digital technology in improving all our supply chain processes, in improving our manufacturing processes, in, you know, customer connect, not only customer connect with the doctors, but also, you know, connect with the patients. Now, nowadays, the patient is also very computer savvy. So patient, you call the patient himself becomes a Google doctor because he searches a lot of information before the patient comes to you. Then since pharma industry also deals with the, mainly deals with the healthcare professionals. So healthcare in general is also impacted because you have wearable technologies where, you know, the ECG can be sent from the patient directly to the customer. So he can actually real time, he can have the information of the patients. So all these things are, you know, various images can be shared. So a lot of things, because pharma and healthcare are allied. So we need to be aware of what is happening in the healthcare front also. And then in what way digital can, you know, help us in improving our process insufficiency, wherever there is insufficiencies there, you need to identify that. And then we have to use to generate customer insights, to generate big data analytics. All these things are, you know, possible.
Right, doctor. Very good insights. Actually, in our company, in Strides, so I am more into the supply chain and manufacturing. But since you belongs to medical affair team, the touch points with the customers is very high for your team. Day in, day out, you have to interact with the doctors, patients, take their feedbacks, understand what is their requirement, how does they want to interact with the applications. And also, obviously, I believe that any digital transformation should start from the customer and then come backward to the technology. Sometimes we, as a technical person or as a business person, we forget this philosophy. We start with the technology. Okay, everybody is experimenting with the AI. Let me experiment with that. But that should not be the case. First, understand the customer and then way back to the technology and identify which technology is going to be best fit for your customer requirement. Moving forward, I'll ask the next question to Raman. Welcome, Raman, to this forum. Similar questions which Anil and Narendra answered. I just wanted to know, what are the challenges which your company faced in the last 6-7 quarters during the pandemic, and how you overcome those challenges? Overall, you can throw some light. Next, I think Dr. Anil raised some very good points, you know, how the digital technology is helping the medical affairs business. So, that question is very interesting, so we have seen that in the last 2 decades, I would say so, the pharma industry has reported the exceptional growth, I would say. The CAGR, if you measure, it is more than 11%. In domestic market, it is 15 to 20%. Foreign market, exports, and all those is also increased like anything. 30 or 35% CAGR was there in some specific market. So we have seen a fantabulous growth of the pharmaceutical industry as a whole, especially the generics, Indian generics market, to export the medicines in the country. But after this COVID, what do you think which tech or what would be the major growth drivers for the pharmaceutical industry in the next 1 to 2 years? I would not go long, like 10 years or 5 years down. Just after this pandemic, maybe in the next 1 year, 2 year, what do you think, which element is going to be the biggest growth drivers for the companies?
I think it's a changing environment, right? Competition is always taking one of the top priority in how we really look at the market. But I think the topmost priority is customer. We are more customer centricity is what's the key lever towards adopting the technology also. Like Dr. Parikh has just said sometime back, right? Customer is more digital savvy than the provider actually in most cases. That's had been the case, right? And that's been driving most of the digital adoption. What happens is that we've been largely outward, which is patient centric. That means our sales and marketing largely still has more digital channel of engagements. But when we look at inside internal, right, operations and all,
yeah,
the digital engagement has been low across the organization. As I think sometime back also you also made a comment that pharma industry by and large has been a laggard. It is to some extent true also. And there is a very clear reason that we have been very compliance heavy and regulated industry. Every single change has to go through multiple processes, multiple approvals, internal as well as external, right? So if there are so many bottlenecks to any change, adopting any change, that's been the key restraint or key issue why pharma industries has not really been able to adopt digital over the years. I think that is changing. Okay, so as I said, one thing is customers, second is regulation and compliance, where which is a bottleneck. But I believe that's what also changing. I believe recent experience of doing remote audit has really given a push to the even regulators to be able to run the audit from a remote location itself. So digital is helping everyone there. So I think convenience is another growth reason or growth lever for the adoption of digital.
Right.
Now, if you have to talk about,
So
these are some things. Then internal adoption. When I'm saying that as Dr. Pai said that. The meetings have been, we have started having meetings more virtually, which was about a couple of 2 years back. It was not even thought of. People would not even, people travel all the ways from one territory to another territory, one region to another region, just to get into a meeting and do the discussions, which has completely changed. But even the business teams are seeing this change, right? So they are now looking at what is more possible using digital. The next part is about cost optimization, driving the optimization of the cost of production, overall cost of production. So I think that's another important part. So while the companies are doing investment, capital investment.
Yeah, interesting points, Narendra. Basically, it is really fascinating to see that somebody sitting in the US with the remote audit from US to the Indian plants. So these things, I believe that it has not been achieved in the past. It is possible because of this COVID, and the COVID has basically empowered the companies to do this kind of necessary things.
Yeah, correct. Sorry, I got disconnected for a little while. So yeah, I think the key thing is that some of the things that I told you about the change of the mindset. One thing, customers driving us over there, the engagement channels driving us over there, and the optimization, cost optimization over a period of time is what the expectations from the digital technologies are also there. Digital technologies have to yet prove that. Maybe in some cases, having the virtual meetings saved a lot of travel cost and all. I think this is expected across other segments, which is not that easy. It is not that direct also. If we really have to talk about manufacturing and bringing in everything over there, that's where we have to really take support from analytics or machine learning, bringing predictive pieces.
Right. Dr. Anil, I would like to ask you related questions. It is more related with the digital workforce management. So, workforce management in the pharmaceutical companies is one of the challenges. The industry has never been used to a scenario where half of the people is working. It is true for any other industry, but for pharma, it is more true. And since we have to deal with the manufacturing plants, our products are getting manufactured, so people has to go to the plant. There is no other way. Right? At the same time, there are a lot of people who are still working from home.
Your voice is in between, not audible. So,
is it audible now?
Yeah, now it's audible. In between, it is not audible.
Okay, so I'll again revise my question. So, doctor, I was asking about this digital workforce management. A lot of people are working from different locations for the pharma companies, and at that, this is also true that a lot of people are going to the plants also. So at the same time, if you see from the top leadership point of view, companies want to maintain the operational resilience and manufacturing resilience with the zero or minimum disruption in the manufacturing area. So how do you think, how does the analytics or automation or digital technology can come here and play a very important and crucial role of maintaining the operational resilience and at the same time workforce agility?
Yeah.
So how the technology can bridge that gap?
I think this is not related to my area of operations directly, because but still I would like to say that the importance of manufacturing was deeply realized during this process, because say in IPCA, one of the drugs are in the earlier part of the pandemic was hydroxychloroquine, and IPCA is the largest manufacturer of hydroxychloroquine in the world. So initially, people were requesting, you know, even government organizations were requesting that. So hydroxychloroquine production had to be there to various, not only to cater to India, but also to various countries around the globe. So manufacturing has to be, you know, there and it has to be uninterrupted sort of things. So during this critical time, I think it was very, very important to maintain the manufacturing, because that is the requirement for the patients, and where the patients would be suffering from the pandemic, and it is one of the drug which is going to help during the pandemic. That was the thinking. Then we had, you know, like paracetamol, it's simple product like paracetamol was exported, not only consumed so much but also exported because of the fever and other things. So This has made people realize the importance of, you know, manufacturing undisturbed. So automation is going to play an important role to play. And then you know, you have to have the integration of the all the various systems. You have to have integration of the manufacturing right from the various machine to human interaction. So you need to, I think, use all these things. The integration of all the systems has to be very, very proper. Although automation is definitely has been going on in pharma industry, but this automation needs to be increased much more than what it is there. Whatever possible, you increase automation to reduce human interaction in production. So that is what the aim of the pharma industry is. And it has been realized during this period that, we need to have more automation, less human interactions. Humans are only there to monitor that everything is going on smoothly, flawlessly. And if there are any manufacturing defects, they can be easily detected and identified by the machine. And then, you know, the workforce will, you know, do that. So you have to have, good mixture of both digital and physical together, as we call, you know, digital as well as physical has to be a proper amalgamation of it has to be there. Earlier, it used to be more mechanical, but now it is going to be more and more digital as you can adopt, so that, you know, you are not completely dependent on your processes for just on the human resource completely. So that That's what I would say. Because, and I would like to talk about, clinical trials. Clinical trials, now you can't go to the sites, the hospitals and the investigators, meet the investigators. So digital monitoring becomes very, very important. And for the doctors also now more an adoption of, see if it is a diabetes trial or it is a, trial of an antihypertensive drug. So you need to capture these data through the digital systems. You have the wearable technologies. So these technologies would be more and more used. Luckily, we were using some of the digital were being used. That's what we could manage. We had electronic data capture of, clinical trial, which was the data which was generated in the patient. Earlier, it used to be purely physical and physical filling the forms and all that. Now it is digitally filled and then we get that and we capture that data electronically. So electronic data capture has been going on. There have been some trials reported which were totally carried out virtually. So virtual clinical trials are also are becoming a possibility. So digital, I think, I feel that we have just scratched the surface. There is a, there is a tremendous potential and we need to, make use of that potential which digital offers. At the same time, the importance of human brains, you cannot undermine. So to manage all these things, you need human brains. So obviously that is what is going to be required. And I would like to say something about your previous question. What are the, now growth drivers for the pharma industry? See, what you realize was that with environmental degradation, with increasing pollution, what is happening is that infectious diseases, which are not thought of earlier, they are becoming rampant. So you need to, invest more in, drugs which you take care of these infectious diseases. So you have to, right from the research to, manufacturing, you have to gear up to take care of these infectious diseases. Other thing is happening is lifestyle diseases are increasing. So there will be increasing growth of the products which are used in lifestyle diseases, like diabetes is exploding, hypertension is exploding, cardiovascular diseases, cardiometabolic diseases are exploding. So we need to gear up for these things. So these will become the growth drivers. So like the Indian market is different from, market in US or the developed market, because there, only the new drugs, innovative drugs, which are under the patent life cycle, they are only marketed. While in India, we have the generic drugs marketed as a brand. So India is a typical market where there's a branded generics. So similarly, the other developing countries, there is a, market of, branded generics. So these are the channels which are there, but disease patterns are changing. So we need to recognize those change in the disease patterns and, work accordingly and shift our strategy accordingly. So this is what I would like to say.
Right, doctor. And I think that we talked about all these big technologies, like manufacturing, we talk about any assistant. We talk about Elon. All these, I would say, multi-million dollars of softwares, which have been years. I think this is the time that these tools are giving you the best ROI. So MES system itself enables a lot of digital workforce, virtual digital workforce enablement is happening. Right now, if I can just give the MES system access to anybody who is sitting any corner in the India, that person can access the data and just by doing some basic analytics, he can tell me that which batch is going good, which batch is not going good, where is the problem, where is the quality issues, what should be our next steps to ensure to achieve the more golden batch kind of thing. So I think that these technologies are giving the ROI in the true sense right now. We have adopted this technology over the years, but right now we are actually harnessing the real power. Right? Next question, I think Narendra, I would like to ask to you. The question is, it's a very interesting question which is coming in my mind right now. Leaders in the pharmaceutical industries are very active. especially after the pandemic. During the COVID-19, many across the industries have been highly responsive, especially the companies which are involved into the production, manufacturing, distribution, and marketing of COVID-related goods. They are super, super active. In the strides also, one of our group companies got 200 million doses of Sputnik. So we know how important and critical the supply chain had been in the last few quarters. The new drug development process or the manufacturing with zero disruptions in this pandemic, where your raw materials come from China, your products are going to US, UK, Australia, Africa, why not everywhere? At the same time, maintain your cost at some level. You cannot ship the product through air because it will increase your cost. All these things are happening. And in the middle of everything, you have to be very, very agile and responsive. So company took a lot of new initiatives which helped them to overcome this issue have never been seen. So Narendra, I would like to know from you, Lupin as a company has taken what kind of new or exceptional initiative in the last 7-8 quarters, which helped the companies to make the path in this.
What I would like to add to what you're saying, the observation is pretty much on the dot. If it is happening in strides, it's actually happening everywhere as well, right? So there are a few things very, very important. One is changing mindset. So I think changing mindset was triggered by COVID. Fortunately, I think that COVID triggered that. I would not say COVID was fortunate, but then the outcome of that one is triggering the adoption part. So mindset was one, first the topmost priority that's changing a bit. Second is that we need to really look at the delivery. How do we deliver these things? Build a roadmap, right? Building a roadmap is something which almost everyone is doing. And just like us, I think almost every other company would have built a roadmap of 3 to 5 years and how they want to be, where they want to be, right? And that basically changes a lot of things. The implementation of that roadmap is another ball game. We cannot really go with the old methodology of deploying the new technology on the shop floor for that matter or any other place. We really need to get into a more tighter control of the project delivery. That means we are largely moving away from waterfall and moving towards agile way of doing things, having a better control on the overall delivery. There are multiple initiatives, as you said, right? There are multiple initiatives and we have to make sure that everything is going on and all the departments who are asking for a solution, they have been serviced properly, right? So delivery mechanism is one thing. Then having the right set of talent pool is another very, very important aspect. I think almost everyone is on a hiring spree for the right talent. I think there is no doubt of a number of offers that we have in the market. So attracting the right talent is a big challenge for everyone. But that's also happening. People are definitely joining, but how and where they are joining is something which is there. Who will be able to solve these 4 or 5 riddles will basically lead the digital transformation in 3 to 5 years timeline. What happens apart from these 2-3 things is also to drive an innovation culture. Digital is a pull, right? But then before you start really looking at these initiatives, you also need to have the right set of ideas. So and ideas can come in from any 1% improvement in the productivity, 2% improvement in the yield optimization, something like that. That can have a direct impact on the business. That can have anywhere between 1, 2 to 3 years of years of ROI, and which is where companies are also looking at the investment part, right? So to be able to set all these things right, to be able to have the right set of people, build the right roadmap and use the right delivery mechanism, is also very, very important apart from the technology by itself. Yeah.
I think these are very good points. Dr. Anil, if I ask you the similar question, what some new initiatives which your department, particularly medical affairs teams, took in the last 7 to 8 quarters?
The initiatives which we have taken is one is, you know, more customer connect with the webinars, with the, you know, advisory board meetings, with the key opinion makers which are there in a particular therapy that we deal with, and then share the information as widely as possible with the important information which is there regarding the disease and also regarding where the product is useful. So that is where, you know, we play a very, very important role. And then I think innovation is one which is, you know, which I feel that which is very, very important. And this is where Indian companies need to go a long way in innovating a product. So when it comes to, you know, new drug discovery, you know, it's a very huge ball game for the Indian companies, because the requirement of bringing a product right from a concept to approval, if you want to launch in an international market, it is almost close to 2.6, 2.8 billion. So which is beyond the most Indian companies are not of that size, like barring just 3-4 companies. So totally new drug discovery is not possible. But what is possible is innovation in the generic space, which we which is possible and which can be, you know, done. And why this innovation in generic space is important, because the multinational companies don't see generic products to drive their business revenue, because that's the scale and the size don't fit them. There, the model of multinational companies that, you know, all new drugs are better than the existing drugs which are out there. But this is where this can be true 8 out of 10 times, but 2 out of 10 times the existing drug is better than the new drug which has come out. And we have worked on this premise, and we have innovated in this generic space. Like, I'll give you an example of clothridone. So we conceived a new dose, 6.25 milligram clothridone, and we marketed it, and it is now widely adopted. So, you know, these are the examples. Then new indication for existing products. So like you called repurposing. So these things can be done. So for that, you need to be, you current era is era of big data analytics. So you have a lot of literature in the domain. So drive that, and you can, derive your information from that, and then you innovate in that space. Another example I would like to give is that, where I am very passionate about is when, in early 2000s, when the, painkillers, which are known as selective COX-2 inhibitors or COXIs, they were there in the market. And, the purpose was to have a GI safely non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. So these were, fulfilling that criteria, but they were becoming cardiac unsafe. So we needed to have a drug which is, GI friendly as well as cardiac friendly. And we found out a generic drug which was there. And today that generic drug is aciclofenac, is being, used by all the companies, marketed very, very widely. So these are the some of the things which, can be done. So in this era of big data analytics, you will have more and more of such ideas. This is just by, reading the journals and, going through the literature. So one person has a limitation of going through the literature. So there is a big data analytics. You can analyze the pattern, what is happening in the disease space, and innovate accordingly. So this is where I think the Indian companies will have to do more, is in the, innovating in the generic space. You can have, we have the large amount of, research and development scientists there in formulation part. So we can design, new formulations which are better than existing formulations. So there is a tremendous scope in to innovate in this space, where the multinationals are not very active. But since we deal with only generic drugs, predominantly Indian companies deal with generic space, there is a scope for innovation which needs to be realized.
Very right, Doctor. Actually, I also believe that this is the place where AI can come and create a real difference. As you rightly said, we have thousands and thousands of literature. It is not humanly possible to read and take the insight and then act. Rather than that, if you can build a true AI system which can ingest all the data, read all the data, and then give the best insight possible, that could be a game changer in the entire digitization. Moving to the, I think we have, Narendra, I would like to know that we all know that now there are a lot of disruptions happening. Companies are responding to digital technology.
Sir, can I request you to put your mic a little bit up because we're losing your voice in the middle.
Yeah. Is it okay now?
Yeah, better. Thank you.
So, I'm saying that the entire landscape is changing. Companies are responding. Digital technologies are coming. So, Narendra, this question would be to you that what is the way ahead for the pharma sector in terms of, you know, their strategy to prepare themselves for the future, and also how can they ensure to not only make them future proof but a sustainable growth trajectory? So what would be your points on that?
I think the answer to the question can be very long. We can spend hours together on this one. I think let me just keep it very brief here, Nitish. I think building a roadmap is very, very important. I also spoke a bit while, you know, ago. Building a roadmap is critically important, and to be able to look at business-led innovation, right? You just cannot do, you know, innovation from IT directly, right? The business team has to really look into the what can be done, right? So I'll just give a few pieces to of success that I can probably talk about. Just a minute.
Sure.
So from any of the initiative, the way that you prioritize is that value has to be looked at. What value of that initiative? Sometimes you can look at 2% improvement can be way better than 5% improvement somewhere else, right? So value. Another key point is that the data is not an expertise. Data is something which is, as many people say, data is oil, right? So much is hidden inside data, so much of information that we don't really look at. We generally look at all the data for our interest. But if we really get into the exploratory data analysis, it can unveil so many different kind of patterns which is there in the data, right? Seasonality, or, you know, depending on different kind of parameters, how the impact on the batch is happening, whether that impact can be negligible, you know, can be reduced, or probably, you know, the positive impacts or catalysts can be, you know, implemented. So that means our golden batch parameters completely can be redefined, right? We really need to look at the data as the core asset. And if you have for last few years data, then you already have that medium core search. The insight that we get from the data is not just an insight if it is not giving us an action, okay? Just by knowing that there's something can be done, right? We cannot really do anything. So action is very, very important. Then we have to scale it up to you know, different geographies or different regions. Then, of course, as I told earlier, is technology and people, which are important part of the overall game. I think important is to drive a roadmap. Take a roadmap audit every year, see where we are, what are the technologies available, what are the trends in the market, and then you reassess yourself and year on a year basis, and modify your strategy about it. I think that's. That will be a couple of bits, I think 2 bits of mine for this. Thank you, Nitesh.
Very, very, very important points, because I also believe that there should be a proper alignment between the business and the IT to make sure that the IT projects, the projects should be successful. Many a times in the pharma industry, we see that the projects like cloud implementation or AI projects or analytics project seen purely from the IT standpoint, that IT or the digital team is the project owners and they should drive it. But this should not be the case. Any project related with this much impact could only be successful if there is a very strong realignment between the IT and the business, and they should work hand in hand. That was a very important point. And second point is also very much relevant. Entire data and analytics, because we talk about data a lot, but how many companies are actually harnessing the potential of data is the real question. How many companies are there in the market which is using the data in their day-to-day actions and then creating the impact is another real, entirely different discussion. The impact of data, impact of analytics is something that is very, very important. So similar question, Anil, which I wanted to ask you. According to your point of view, how the pharma companies should see way forward for in terms of digital technologies, in terms of options. How do you think that companies should make their strategy around the
digital? Yes, what I believe is that digital is here to stay, and the pharma companies will need to now a substantial part of the budget is going to go into the should go into the digital technology. So having realized that there is a definite potential of these technology, because technology itself is not you, it's technology is an enabler. So it is enabling you, so you have, and you have realized this potential, how remote working is possible, how remotely you can connect with your customers, how it is all operation efficiency you can drive out of the this technology. So you need to assess the right technologies which are required for your various operations and your various workings, and then invest in them. So, and then there is a tremendous potentials of this technology at all levels, right from, as I said, right from research and development. The potential is there in manufacturing, the potential is there in supply chains, the potential is there in marketing, the potential is there in customer connect. So everywhere the technology is now omnipresent now. So you can't say that you can do without technology. So you have to have the right, only challenge would be what is the right technology suitable to you. So for that you need experts who can guide you where. So this is the potential of this technology, and this is what you need. But now there is no going away from digital. So that is not there. So I think I would like to mention the Cowin application. You can see that Cowin application is a fantastic where so many entire population of India has been and that is giving now more and more ideas, because all data of all population of such a huge country can be there in them, and then you have health data, you have the disease data, and then the possibilities are tremendous and totally limitless. So I think so digital is here to stay. Only thing you need to identify what is your requirement and what is your budget and how much investment you can do in that digital. But it is here to stay.
Correct. And I completely agree with you, Dr. Ravi. I also believe that digital is a mindset. Right? It's a journey. It's not a destination where you have some start point and you are going to be on that journey. You want, or if you do not want, that is beyond your control. Because if you are not going to change yourself, somebody else will come and that company will change. So if you see this Fortune 500 list, somewhere I was reading that some 20% companies in the last 10 years has been wiped out, and 20% new companies has been placed. Why all these things are happening? Because those companies are not able to change with the time, or change with the culture, or change with the people's requirement. Biggest example, you can see Nokia mobile phone and all this. They have been replaced. So yeah, digital, I completely agree with you. Digital is a mindset. It's a journey. It's not a destination. And when we talk about digital, we always talk about technology. If you talk about some people, they have opinion that digital is nothing but cloud, AI analytics, that. But that is a very narrow way to think the entire digital. Right? According to me, technology is one pillar of the digital, but there is two very, very important pillars which we generally overlook. One is the business impact or the business. And second is the customer experience. These two are also very, very important and integral part of the entire digital upgrade. Technology is just an enabler. You can name cloud, AI, data, and everything. But at the end of the day, what you are doing with that technology is to create the business impact, creating new channels, creating new business model, creating new revenue sources. And then at the same time, building the customer experience is something that make the whole dots together. And that is the true definition. So, I think that this would be the right way to understand the digital and to implement the digital in the form of it.
Thank you so much, Dr. Anil Parekh, and thank you so much, sir, Mr. Nitish, for giving us a vast expanse into this subject and for your thoughts on this impact of digitalization and the journey that you all experienced over the last 2 years. So please accept a small token from ELIAC's Digital Pharma Summit for taking out your valuable time and being present here. So we have a certificate for Mr. Narendra Saini. I believe he's dropped out of the call. We also have a certificate for Dr. Anil Parekh and, of course, Mr. Nitish Kumar for moderating this session. Thank you so much for your time and your valuable insights to all the panelists. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thanks, Karima. Thanks, Dr.